Okay, so the first thing that we're going to go ahead and grab is going to be this spool holder. Okay? And we're going to end up constructing this spool holder and putting it together so we have that out of the way. So we're going to need one side, which is going to be these pieces. And then we're going to need bottom base plate. And also we're going to need this Allen wrench. This Allen wrench should be the second smallest in your package. Alright, so to kind of put this guy together, what we're going to do is we're going to insert the tabs here and make sure that this nut falls into place right here. So I like to hold my finger against the screw so that it's pushed all the way in, and then just kind of tilt and slide in the posts. And so it can be a little bit hard to put together sometimes, but just try it and be a little soft with it so that we don't break the acrylic. And we should be good to go here in a minute. If you have any trouble with it, let me know. And I want this training to go more as like a conversation between you and I. And if you have any questions or anything, I would love for you to ask me and just stop me from where I am so I don't get too far ahead. Just ask if you have any problems or can't figure something out. And so I'm going to go ahead and construct the other side real quick.
Do you have to undo the whole thing?
Yeah, so you're going to want to make this almost all the way at the end of this screw. Sorry. So you're going to want to do the knot at the end of the screw in order to put it on. It'll help out a whole bunch. Yeah, like out like that. Mm-hmm. And then it should go together a little bit easier. So you might not want to take it off because it's going to be hard to get on later. So you want it just as a tip. So I can show you one more time if you'd like. So kind of all the way, so it's kind of flat with the screw head. If you can see that. Then I'm just going to kind of lay that into its spot here. And then push it into the sides. And you don't want it too tight, you just want it snug, so we don't want to break the acrylic that we're using. So once you've got it tight enough, good. Just like that.
Let me see if this works.
You won't have to do this every time. This is just something that we kind of have to do from it shipping to you and from the packaging.
Okay.
And so these can stay constructed as long as you don't need to like deconstruct them to make them package into a better means or anything. And you shouldn't have to do that. Other than maybe instructing students to do it and get them to kind of construct the other ones.
Okay, see.
So it's supposed to be like this.
You need a what?
They're logged in with their computer too, aren't they?
Yeah.
Then you can log out.
Did I do this
wrong? Move the computer out.
Oh, no, I did not.
I muted one. Let's see if that helps. It won't?
It's a different way. So. And then you just have to tighten it.
Okay. Well, it only happens sometimes, so we'll see. Okay, so how are we feeling on the filament holder there?
I think I got one side done.
Awesome.
Me too.
Yeah, that's looking good. Yeah, and then the other side goes in the exact same way.
Okay. I think I got one side done.
So I'm kind of getting an echo from there being like two microphones picking up your voices. If we could decide on one microphone, that would be excellent.
Okay, I think we're...
Yeah, it's just kind of getting that cross noise from each other.
Okay, I think we're... Are you still getting it?
No, it seems pretty good right now. If I do get it again, I'll let you know.
Okay.
Okay, once you kind of have that filament holder together, we also have one of these bolts, and there's going to be nuts on either end. That's actually what sits in between the two plates, like that.
Are you still getting it?
Yeah. And once you have that finished, we can actually decide to put one of these big filament spools, and we're just going to lay it in like so. And we're going to place the nut and bolt through. And now we got something that can let our filament spin.
Does it matter if it comes towards you or needs to come from above?
No, usually I like it the plastic coming over the top. And so
okay.
You were to look at it kind of going that way. Yeah. Into the printer a little bit better.
Okay.
And then you can set that to the side because it's going to take us a little while to move on to the printer. All right, so now that we've kind of got the filament here together, and we're feeling comfortable with that, so I'm going to tell you a little about what we're going to do in this train. So the first...
Can you wait just a second? We have one filament in.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Masa, you're over there.
Okay, there you go.
Yeah, you put that up. And you put this in between it and make sure they're the
fingers.
Okay.
We're good.
Awesome.
Thank you for waiting.
Yeah, of course. Okay, so what we're going to go over in this training is first we're kind of going to go over the steps to print, and then we're going to go over some troubleshooting issues. And we're also going to go over basic setup and checking out your printer. So I kind of wanted to give you a little bit of guidance of what we're going to go through here, and then we should be more in line. So the first kind of thing we're going to talk about is the steps to print. And that's going to involve the first big step, and that's called the design process. And this includes anything from CAD modeling to creating designs from online to basically utilizing an object to either informationally model or creating yourself in order to prototype or make a useful type of structure. And that's going to be the biggest kind of problem that you come across. A lot of what you're going to focus on is the design process and how to create objects within a 3D modeling environment. And it's going to take practice and it's going to take a little effort to get through, but that is definitely something you and your kids can also work through and develop together. And so we recommend a couple of CAD programs. So one of them is going to be Tinkercad. And Tinkercad is free and it's cloud-based and it's also online. So all you would have to do is have a web browser. So this does work on Chromebooks. And then you would be able to create these objects and use this program. So just before I get into the next one. Yes.
Was that Tinkercad? What was that?
Tinkercad, yes. So it's T-I-N-K-E-R.
Is that Tinkercad? Okay.
And then the last one is C-A-D. So I'm getting that ring a little bit again. Could one of you disable your own mics? Okay, it seems like it kind of went away there.
Okay.
Oh, well, that'll work too. So if you can kind of both collaborate with that, that would be awesome.
Okay.
So what, have you had any experience with 3D printing or CAD modeling?
No.
Okay. And what age groups are you kind of teaching?
I will be working with 9th through 12th grade.
Okay, awesome. So Tinkercad is a great introduction for 9th to 12th grade, but you're most likely gonna probably wanna work in something like Onshape. And Onshape is much more like a traditional type of CAD program. And what it actually does is it creates a 2D sketch on a plane, and then you create it into an object by either extruding it or manipulating that original sketch to make a full-blown design. And that's going to be the second one. So you're gonna have Tinkercad, which is a great introduction, and it's usually right around from elementary to middle school, and then it kind of transfers into Onshape just because it's a little bit easier for older students to visualize and get that 3D model in their heads. And then right past Onshape is going to be something we recommend is called Inventor. And Inventor is going to be a robust and actually used in the market for manufacturing right now, and it just has so many functions it can be a little overwhelming. So that's why we kind of recommend taking the steps from Tinkercad to Onshape to Inventor, depending upon kind of what you're going through. And
okay.
Inventor and Fusion 360 are very close and very similar. The only difference is Fusion 360 is cloud-based and you can collaborate with multiple people, while Inventor is a single-seat program and it's installed on a computer by itself.
And wait, which one did you say was cloud-based?
The Fusion 360, and that's made by Autodesk.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And all of those are free for educators. Most of Autodesk's big compilation of modeling and everything that they use for their software is free for anyone with an EDU email, and you should be able to sign up with that. And it should give you about a 3-year license, so it's pretty lenient, and it gives your kids the opportunity to use it outside of your classroom and to continue working through that kind of design process. And so if you kind of feel like you're overwhelmed with these new CAD programs that I kind of told you about, then we do have some support links online at our website, and you can go to there, and there's a couple training videos to kind of give you, you know, the basic setup and the introduction to Tinkercad. And I should be working through an Inventor one rather soon. And you can always use those, but also Onshape has their own training tutorials on their website. And so that's something your students could work through, or you can kind of experience and then pass on that knowledge. And so the idea here is to, of course, get our students to start using that 3D modeling software and get into that more design and iteration. All right, so the second step to printing is slicing the G-code. So what we do whenever we have the file in our window or CAD program, we're going to export it as a .stl file. And what the .stl file is, it's taken and it's put into another program called a slicer. And what the slicer does is it converts the STL into a language that our printers can end up understanding. And so it's a whole bunch of numeric positions. And so it goes through layers upon layers, and it basically is a robotic crazy hot glue gun, is what these 3D vendors are. And so it tells it where the crazy glue gun should go. And so that's what we're kind of going to go over next. So if you could, we have a new version of Cura and an older version of Cura, and you're welcome to set up either or. If you would prefer the old one, you can tell me. Otherwise, I'm going to go on with the 262, and you can download Cura, which is spelled C-U-R-A, on the Ultimaker website. So if you were to type into Google and just say C-U-R-A, it should be the first link that pulls up, and I would like you to download 2.62 so that we can install it on your computer.
You said C-U-R-L?
C-U-R-A.
And download the 2.6.2?
Yes, that is correct. And I'm going to go ahead and open mine, and I'll show you a screen that you'll come to, and whenever you get to that screen, I want you to let me know so we can continue on. And it might take a little while to download. The download should be somewhere around like 43 megabytes, I believe, so it might take a little bit. You're going to install it kind of just like every other program. Just make sure you click the next options. We do want to install Arduino drivers, so there'll be a little box that pops up and it'll have checkboxes. We do want to enable Arduino drivers. They should be auto-enabled. I just want you to double check for it. And then we can click next through that, and then you should pop up to this screen I'm about to share with you.
Okay. On here it says select your 3D model. Is yours on here?
Oh, on the Cura website, the drop-down box that says what are you using this for?
Yes, it's select your main 3D printer.
Yeah, if you would, if you actually click on the very, whenever you first click on it and you just scroll down to, I don't want to share my information, it'll automatically download it for you. Because it is asking you for a lot of stuff.
Okay. Download. Oh, okay.
Did you find it?
Yes.
Awesome. All right, so this is kind of the next step that we're going to go through. We're going to go through all of the settings on our slicer. And so what I'm going to do now is I'm going to actually transfer over to a screen share, and we'll kind of step through that together, and then we'll move on to setting up the printer and troubleshooting. All right, so whenever you get to this screen that says add printer and it has this Cura in the background, I would like you to let me know.
Okay, it's still opening.
Okay. Thank you. So is the download pretty close to finishing?
It just popped up the wizard.
Yeah. And you should be able to next through those and make sure we have the Arduino driver selected in the checkboxes. And then we should be able to click next again, and then it should open up the screen that you see me with.
It says Cure Loading Machines 2.6.2.
Okay, so am I just...
I guess it's trying to open it.
Yeah, I think it's trying to open it right now, and it's about to pull you into this new screen.
Okay, yeah, now it says Add Printers.
Yes, that's perfect. And it has Ultimaker, Custom, and Other as the bold options, right?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Then we are on the right track. So are you ready to go through these options with me?
Yes.
All right, so what we're going to do first is we're going to click on Custom. And that's going to select a custom FDM printer, which makes us kind of choose all the settings for it. So I'm going to change the printer name, and I'm going to change it to NWA3D, and I'm going to type in A5, because that's the type of printer you guys have.
That's on the Add Printer?
Yes.
NWA3D space A5, and that's the type of printer.
Okay.
And then we're just going to click Add Printer in the right-hand side.
All right.
It should pop us up to a new screen that says Machine Set. Yeah. And so here we're going to have to change a couple things because these aren't quite right for our particular printer. So first off, we have X Width. And that value is actually going to be 125 millimeters.
So 125.
Yep. And then the depth is going to be 150.
So depth 150.
Yep. And then height is going to stay at 100 millimeters. And so that defines our 5x6x4 inch build area.
Okay.
Okay, and the build plate shape is rectangular, and then make sure both of those next two options are unselected because it doesn't have a heated bed and we don't want it to be in the center.
Okay.
Okay, and then the G code should be RepRap Marlin, and I think it should auto select that. And then we're going to change these settings on the right hand side. And we're going to change all of those down to gantry height to 0.
Okay, so all the print head settings.
Yes.
Go to 0.
Exactly. And then finally, we'll have the gantry height also at 0.
Okay. Are you getting that?
Yeah.
Okay. And then gantry 0.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And then we have one extruder on our printer, so we're going to leave that value. And then we're also going to change the material diameter. So if you were to look on the side of your plastic that you have, there should be a sticker like this one. And so this sticker says PLA, which is the type of plastic, and then it also says a size, which that size is 1.75. And so that's what we're going to change the value to.
Okay. Mine was automatically 1.75.
That's awesome. Should be good then.
Okay.
And then the nozzle size is also 0.4 for our printer, so we should be good. Now we can click Finish. And you should be at this same screen, is that right?
Yes.
Awesome. Okay, so what we need to do now is we need to go through a couple more settings just to kind of set up how your print's going to actually work and make sure that it comes out nicely for our first print. So let's click on over here and click the slider and go from recommended to custom. And yours will probably be all grouped together. If you just click on the arrow and drop down, it should give you the individual settings.
Okay. Do I need to put all those to open right now, or?
You can open them as we go through them. That is fine.
So okay.
This section has a lot of information, and if you feel like you're overwhelmed or you want me to explain it in a different way, just let me know and just kind of say, hey, I don't get that. Can you re-explain that? So the first one we're going to talk about is layer height. And so this does determine your quality. And what it means by quality is how smooth or how nice it will look on the outside of your object. And for general terms, we like to say anywhere from 0.3 to 0.1 is a good range for our layer height. 0.1 will be the nice quality, and 0.3 will be a low quality. So I'm going to put it right in the middle at 0.2. Next, we have our shell, and it's going to contain wall thickness and top and bottom thickness. So what that means is that the walls for our object, or anything that's on the outside border, is actually going to be at least 0.8 millimeters. And we want that to be a multiple of our nozzle size. Since our nozzle size is 0.4, 0.8 works great for us. Next, we're gonna have infill density. And infill density determines a lot of the durability that your object has when printed off. And we like to say anywhere from 5 to 20% is a good range while still maintaining a decent print speed and a small amount of plastic use. So I'm going to go ahead, for the sake of time and the print speed, I'm going to change it to 5%.
Okay. And you said, what was it, 5 to what?
Anywhere from 5 to 20% is a good range.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And that's for the infill density.
Correct.
I don't see on yours, I have a gradual infill steps.
You have. So this is, you probably see me open this big setting screen.
Mm-hmm.
You can choose a lot more settings than the ones you see now, but we kind of hide those so that you can get used to the settings that we're using and kind of manipulate those and then kind of expand more. And the gradual infill, okay. Means if you just leave it at zero, it should still print the infill in the exact same way as it does normally.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Next up, we're going to have the printing temperature. Most PLA is printed at 210 degrees Celsius. The PLA we use typically has a special component in it that makes it much more flexible. And so you can actually do that by kind of twisting this around your finger. And one thing about that is if you try this with any other PLA, it will break extremely fast. And so it's much more rigid. And so since that's the case, we need to print this particular PLA at a higher temperature. So we're going to use 220 degrees Celsius.
Okay. So printing temp 220.
Yes. And PLA stands for polylactic acid. And it's actually made from, it's a biodegradable material made from cornstarch.
Okay.
So next up, we're going to have the diameter. And we're going to also change the diameter here to that of our filament. So do you remember what that was?
I believe it was 1.75 or 4.5.
It was 7.5, and you're exactly right.
Okay, 1.75.
We're gonna leave our flow percentage at 100% because in general terms, the object that we create or we design is going to be perfect, right? And it should print off great at 100%. And so if you were to change this flow value, it either puts out a little bit more plastic or a little bit less plastic, depending upon your percentage. And so we're just going to leave that alone for now. And that's something you can experiment with as you become more comfortable. And we also want to make sure that traction, retraction is enabled. And so that checkbox should already be marked.
Yes.
Awesome. Okay, the next part is going to be our speed. So I may have a couple more settings than you do, just because I've kind of been playing around with this program, but the print speed that we're going to use is 50 millimeters per second.
Okay, so change sprint speed to 50?
Yes.
Okay.
And we use 50 because it's a little bit slower than the maximum that these printers can go. And we say the maximum is 60 millimeters per second, but it tends to make the print quality look a little bit bad. So we like to reduce the speed in order to make sure that we have a nicer print quality and it prints correctly.
Okay.
And then you may also see travel speed. We say that travel speed should be roughly 2 times the amount of your print speed. Even though it's 120 here, it's still good, and it's basically the distance that if it's here on one object and it needs to go over here, that's how fast it'll move in between those points. Next, we should have cooling, and we do want to enable print cooling.
Okay.
The next section should be support, and let's check the box for generate support.
So change that and check it?
Yeah, so we want to check generate support, yeah. And what's going to happen is it's going to place a couple more options down below, and we can kind of sort through those, but first is going to be the support placement. And it we like to use everywhere, and that's just to ensure that whatever model we have does get support. And so what support means is anything that's over a 45 degree angle, or 50 degrees in this case, will generate a support, which means if it's printed in midair, it's actually going to print off onto the support instead of falling down.
Okay.
Do you have any more settings under that I need to go over?
I just have on support, just generate support and support placement. That's the only things I have.
Awesome. Okay. Next, we're going to have build plate adhesion. And we like to say skirts are usually pretty useful for almost all of your builds, and it kind of defines the outside area that your object will have after printing. You may also use brim as an option to help suction plate the print onto the build area. And so what I kind of mean by that is if you have problems with the layers kind of lifting up on the sides, one thing you could try to do is put a brim onto that object and hopefully it will stay closer to the build plate. If you still find a couple problems with that, then you could always try releveling and it should fix your issue.
So this is going to be based on what we're making, if we'll do the build plate adhesion type.
Yes.
So like if I did a large button for my special ed kids, like a jumbo size for them, would I want to do the brim?
So you're making a big button?
Like one of the projects that my kids are going to do is I'm going to have my special ed kids, or I'm going to have some of my student make manipulatives for special ed students.
Okay.
And one of them would be like a jumbo size 4-hole button.
Okay.
So
yeah.
Wanted to do that, would it be skirt or brim?
It depends on how it prints off kind of the first time. So if it prints off and you see it curve up a whole bunch on the side like this, then you might want to put a brim on it. But I would try it first with a skirt.
Okay.
And that'll just help it to stay less curved.
Okay. So then I need to change that right now because it's set at brim.
I would change it to skirt because a brim creates a whole bunch of layers on the bottom of your object and it can create a lot more time on your print.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And then the next three ones, we're not going to touch on in this video. So that is something that you can experience with by changing settings, but I think everything in those should be good. We don't use dual extrusion, and the special modes, the only other option there is either all at once or one at a time. And we want to print all of our objects at once.
Yeah. Now, I don't have experimental on here, but I don't need that.
No, you don't need that. That's just an extra setting.
Okay.
All right. So that is the settings that we went through. And of course, you can always look at this video again if you have any questions about kind of what those are. And then if you notice, whenever you hover over one of these, it does create a dialog box that tells you what's kind of going on for that specific setting.
Okay. Now, since I've done this, do I need to click where it says save to file?
You do not.
So, or is it just automatically saving these changes?
Yes, it'll automatically save these changes to the printer that we made. So this will always be true whenever okay. you load the NWA3D A5 printer settings. If you log into this computer with a different account, you will have to recreate these settings. These are user specific.
Okay.
All right, so kind of the next part that we're going to go over is we're going to actually load a file into this. So remember, we took an exported file of an STL, and we're going to put it into this slicer program to make it ready for our printers. So if you come, and I told you to grab that micro SD card, right?
Yes.
And in the end is a small micro SD card.
Yes.
Awesome. So we can go ahead and keep that in the USB, and I want you to plug that into your computer. And so it should
title
NWA3D. Go ahead.
Did you say there was something in the USB?
Yeah, there should be a little small micro SD card.
Oh, okay. At the bottom of it.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
And so I just want you can keep that inside there, and then we just want to plug the USB into our computers.
Okay.
And then it should pull up either what do you want to do with this drive, but you can kind of close that because we're actually going to open it from Kira. So once you plug it in, we're going to click up here in the top hand, left-hand corner of the window and say open file. And then you're going to want to navigate to that drive that you just plugged in, and it should be titled NWA3D.
Yes.
You should see these files inside of it. You might not see the top two, but you should see the other three folders and, just the three folders. I'm sorry. And what we're going to choose here is STL files.
In my computer. And yep. You said click STL files.
Right.
Okay.
We're going to open that folder, and inside it, we should see an NWA3D keychain and also a six-sided dice. Do you have a preference of which one you'd like to load?
What's the difference? Oh, wait, are we doing – what do you want to do? Okay, we'll do the keychain.
Okay. So just go ahead and double click on the keychain. And you should pop up in your little box.
Mm-hmm.
And so you can kind of zoom into the box, and the movement controls for the camera are a little bit difficult to get used to. But if you're using a touchpad or a mouse, space helps you zoom in further. And also if you're using a actual mouse, you can use the scroll wheel to zoom in. If you right-click and rotate the mouse, you should be able to rotate the box around.
Okay, so there we go.
Yeah. We're approaching just at the hour training mark, but I'm going to stay with you as long as possible so that we can get your printers up and running, because it's exactly what this training is for. And I want you to be ready for your students when they come in.
Thank you so much.
Oh, yeah, of course. All right, so what we're going to do next is we're going to talk about a little bit of manipulating these objects in Kira. And so if you click on the keychain itself, you should be able to move it around with these arrows or changing these values in the top left of the window. The selection below that is called scale. And so by selecting scale, either changing the percentage or the millimeters, we can either decrease or increase the size of our keychain.
Okay.
Next, we're going to have rotate. And by grabbing any one of these axes, we can rotate the object in that direction. It does have snap rotation, so it snaps by either 5 degrees or I believe it's 5 degrees snapping. No, it's 15 degrees is what it snaps by. If you don't want it to snap rotation, you can always click the box that's directly under and disable it.
Okay.
All right, one other thing I want to show you is down towards the bottom, it's called view mode. And so what view mode does is we have solid, x-ray, and layers. And I find that layers is extremely helpful. So if we click on that, it'll actually generate the object in a different way. And so what we see is something more like this kind of yellow and red, and it looks a little different, right?
Well, mine doesn't look like that.
Doesn't look like that?
Uh-uh. You said layer?
Yeah, we're going to click view mode on the left-hand side here. And then we're going to choose layers.
Okay, mine doesn't have any red in it.
Okay, so there's some options here on the left-hand side, where it pulls up a kind of a dialog box for us to select settings. And it has show travels, show helpers, show shell, and show infill. And if you select one of those values, it should appear.
Okay, I have extruder one, show travels, show helpers, show shell, show infill. And the only thing that's not clicked is the show travels.
So does it kind of look like what mine is right now?
No, it's yellow. And it looks like the website on the keychain is backwards.
Okay. So if we click on show and layers and you grab this little slider here on the side and move it up, it should show you more layers than just that one.
It does. It still didn't have that color. And mine just shows like a lot of lines for the color.
Okay. Can you show me on the screen?
Can you see that?
Yeah, I can see it.
Okay.
Did it slice it already?
What's that?
So what it does whenever we click on layers is it generates a mode that slices the object into lots of different flat planes. And it should be, if it did, it should say ready to save to removable drive in the bottom right hand of the corner, or of the window, sorry.
It does say over here, save to removable drive.
Okay, I just wanted to double check with you on that one.
So does it need to have the red in there?
I think you should be, can, if you select this slider on the left-hand side in our dialog box and scroll down through the layers, does it change?
Yes.
Okay, yeah, then it should be good. I think it's just not displaying those color values for you. It shouldn't have
any problems.
You do still see NWA3D on the top, correct?
When I go all the way down, if I go up, or if I'm in the middle, it doesn't show anything.
Okay,
really.
So if you're at the very top at 11 is what mine has, do you see NWA3D across the top?
Not really. It looks kind of, but not really anything.
Not super visible.
Yeah.
Okay, so how about you go over here and click on Show Shell and unselect that option and reselect the option.
unselected. It's still the same.
Still the same kind of thing? Okay. One thing we could do is reload the model. So if you right-click on our model that we have right now and say delete selected model,
okay,
it'll take it away. And then we can reload, and hopefully it'll generate it this time.
And I go to File, Open Files.
Correct.
Keychain.
Yes.
The keychain's on. It still looks the same.
It looks good.
So it doesn't need any, that's fine right there like that?
Yeah, it looks good. From what I can see, it looks good on the screen.
Okay, so it doesn't need the red like yours has on there?
No, it's not necessary.
Okay, how can I get, is there a way I can get that on there to look like yours with the red?
I think it may be a setting that I have changed, and I'm not positive on instructing you through that.
Okay.
But it does look correct, and it looks like it will print just fine.
Okay.
So next, the only portion that we need to do is we need to save it to the removable drive. So if you do want to click in the bottom right-hand corner and click Save to Removable Drive, in the bottom window of the editable screen, you can also see that we can rename it here. And you'll see the amount of material that is required along with the time that it'll take.
Okay.
And so this is typically a good estimate, and this can be anywhere from 5 to -5 minutes based upon what happens with the printer itself.
Mm-hmm.
So let's go ahead and click Save to Removable Drive.
Okay.
And then we can click Eject in here in the bottom left. Or in the middle of the screen, sorry. And that should eject our USB drive.
It says Cure collects anonymous slicing statics. You can dismiss this in preferences. Do I just dismiss?
Yeah, you can just dismiss that. It's just telling you that it sometimes collects data based upon how you slice the item. And you can change that in your preferences if you don't want it to collect anonymous data.
Okay. Now the eject button didn't come up.
That's right. Instead, you can always go to your program files and you can right click on the drive and select eject. So if we open up a little window and then come to, here, let me plug mine back in real quick. So I pulled up the NWA3D, and if I right-click on it and just select Eject, it should be able to pop out.
Okay.
And that's just safety to make sure that everything got transferred to the SD card and nothing's messed up when we change it.
It says, warning, save any open files on this disk, and then close the file program.
Yeah, it's probably talking about Cura. It probably wants you to make sure you save the file, close the program, and then eject.
Okay. So it should already be saved, and then I can just push continue?
Yes.
Okay.
All right, so now we should have our little USBs, right?
Hmm.
And now the only thing that we would have to left to do in order to print this object that we just loaded on here is to plug it into the printer and click print. And although that would be super easy this time, we kind of need to go through some first time setup tips. And so what you can do with this little SD card is right here in the front of the printer, there is a port, and it's very skinny and very small. There's going to be a USB port next to it, and then there's going to be a tiny area that you can slide.
Is there a way I can pull up the picture of you in the printer? It's still on the screen.
Oh, yeah. I'm sorry. That's my fault. Is that better?
Yes.
Awesome. Okay. Yeah, so here it is, right in the front of the printer. So it's directly beneath the twist knob. Right here.
Okay.
So if you slide the SD card into there, normally we would be ready to print and we'd be good to go. But we still need to go over a couple troubleshooting tips just because it was in shipping and sometimes we never know what comes out of that.
Okay, so I take at the back of the thing the little SD card out.
Yes. And that
and push into
will go here. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
You should feel it kind of click.
And how do I know if I have it? I think I did.
Okay. Well, if it's not, we can always check it here in a minute, and the printer will tell us it doesn't find an SD.
Okay.
All right. So this next section that we're going over is going to be the troubleshooting tips that we talked about. So first, we kind of talked about designing and creating an object, and then we went to slicing the G-code, or going from an STL file to a G-code that the printer can use. And now we're going to talk about some objects or troubleshooting tips for your printer. So the first kind of tip that we're going to go over is cure settings. And that is something to always check first if you're having problems with your print or it doesn't seem like it's doing anything right. And it seems a little bit difficult. It's recommended that you should go and check on your Cura settings. And since we just roll print those, we know those are right. The next kind of step to troubleshooting is going to be just a basic machine check. So that's going to be mechanical errors. And we can decide anything on here. It could be mechanical, but there's some specifics we'd like for you to check. So first off, we're going to go ahead and check the motor plugins. And so all of these wires that are kind of out here on the back have a little label on them like this X. And we want to make sure all of those are plugged in correctly to our motors and that we shouldn't have any issues when we do turn it on.
Okay. So you said there's a little X where?
So you'll see on the wire here that it does have an X. So there's going to be that X. There should be wires that say Y. And there should be another wire that says E, or extruder. And then finally, we'll have a B wire.
Okay, so
yeah,
it looks like the two back here are Y and Y.
Yes.
That one says Y. That one says Y. And then, I can't see what that says.
Mm-hmm. And then you should have
it's a space in the thing. Z?
Yeah. That's right. And then
okay, yeah.
On the arm, it's going to be X.
Okay. X, and then E's back here.
Yeah, E's back here. On
right here.
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
And so it looks like it's all plugged in, and it should be pretty decent. We just want to go over it up.
So,
the
arm is,
go ahead.
The arm's E. The side's going to be X.
Yes.
And the back is going to be the three Ys.
Right. You'll have one Z here at the bottom. And then right in here is going to be Ys.
Okay.
And that's just telling you each motor and kind of which axis they move on.
Okay.
And then E stands for extruder, and that's what actually powers our plastic to go through. All right, so everything looks good there. The next part is to double check the belts that are holding our motors together. And so that's going to be our transfer of power. And so if you just check for that they're taut and that they're not loose or anything, then we should be good on this. So you're going to have one here on the arm, and you're going to have one here under the build plate. Right.
So these right here?
Yeah, that looks good.
Okay.
And they have those wire cables, I guess, on them. Those stay on there?
Yes, those do stay on there.
Okay.
All right. So that's kind of just a basic mechanical check that we're going to go over for our printers. And you don't have to do that every time. We just wanted to double check because it has been through shipping, and UPS can be a little rough with packages. So that was our second troubleshooting step. So the first one was Kira. The second one is kind of machine or mechanical errors. And then the next really, really big one is going to be leveling the build plate. And so this can also be considered a mechanical error, but it's almost in a category of its own because it's done so often. And that's if you move something or you have to locate it into a different spot and you just want to double check and make sure that it is level. So that's what we're going to go over now. If you could grab a piece of paper, any piece of normal printer paper would be great.
Okay. Okay, it's printer paper.
Okay, and then we're gonna fold it hamburger style.
All right.
And so this distance is right at about 200 microns. And this distance is what we want our extruder nozzle to be from the build plate to lay down a good bead of plastic. So if you could think of like a toothpaste and a toothbrush, if you hold the toothpaste extremely close to it and squeeze down, it's going to fling everywhere because the bristles are brushing past it, right? Now, if we have it too high, it's going to kind of string and glob everywhere. But if we have it just right, it produces a nice bead across the toothpaste. And so that's what we want the extruder to do. So that's what we're doing for leveling. So next, what I'm going to do is we're going to look at the printer. And I want you to click down once on the twist knob, and we're going to go to setup, and then we're going to click again, and then we're going to select the value auto home.
So click knob.
Click setup auto home.
Setup, and then auto home.
Correct. And so what's going to happen is your printer is going to start moving. And what it's trying to do is move all of your axes to 0, 0, 0. And this is our base point. The reason we do this is so we get the nozzle to its 0 point, and then we can level it.
Okay.
So did it kind of all shrink all the way down to the build plate?
It's
Moving.
Okay.
Is that keychain image stored on here now?
I think we'll have to do it on there.
Okay.
That had to be the SD in there.
Okay.
The keychain is stored on the SD card, yes.
Okay.
And so we'll just have to select that when we're ready to.
Okay.
So it looks like it got to 000. And now we're going to have to disable motors. So again, we're going to go into, we're going to click it once, we're going to go setup, and then we're going to click disable motors. And now it should let you move this build plate freely and also the extruder assembly.
Okay, wait, it should do what now?
You should be able to move this build plate now.
It's not moving.
Okay, go ahead and try and disable motors again.
Set up, disable motors. It's still not moving. Oh, it's moving front to back. Okay. Yeah. Now. And what else did you say?
This big fan, the fan that's spinning right now, should be able to move sideways.
Good. Okay.
There you go. Awesome. Okay, so we have everything ready for us to level. So we're going to leave it in that spot, and I'm going to kind of move my printer around, and I'm going to show you the pieces that we're going to be leveling with. And you don't want to move your printer because we do want it on a flat surface so we can level it better. And so I'm just showing you this for demonstration purposes. And so directly underneath here, you can see this knob. And so this is one of three knobs that we're going to use to make the build plate flat to the printer head. So that's the first one. You're going to have two here on the outside. So you'll have one here and one here.
Okay.
So what we're going to do is we're going to take that little nozzle that you can see, and we're going to put it directly above that one here in the middle. And so we want this.
Okay, wait, how?
So we want the extruder nozzle directly above the twist knob. So I know it's a little difficult for you to see it on my screen, but we want the print head directly above that knob.
And the print head's what now?
This right here.
Okay. So that means the plate has to come up.
So just like this. So it should be right at about that spot for it to be directly above it.
How are we going to know if we get it directly above?
Well, you won't know if it's specifically directly above, but we're kind of using that as an estimate so that it's at its best point.
Okay.
Okay. What we're going to do now is we're going to slide our piece of paper that we folded. We're going to slide it under that nozzle. And so if you're having
mine doesn't go all the way.
So did it go under the nozzle all the way?
It doesn't go all the way through. It's hitting something.
Okay, so it's probably hitting our nozzle. So if you push down here on this build plate, it's actually on springs. And you can move it down in order to slide the paper underneath.
Okay.
So if you couldn't get through the first time, go ahead and move the build plate and push down on it and slide the paper under.
Okay.
And so next, what we're going to do is we're going to feel a certain amount of tension that the printer nozzle has with the paper. So try and move the paper in and out. And if it feels really loose, it's too far away. And if it feels like mine, which is making the paper buckle like this, it's too close. So we want to find a happy medium where it's a small amount of tension on the paper. This is something you could probably feel to kind of imagine what it should feel like, is if you were to put your finger on a piece of paper and try and slide it, you want it at that tension that just barely moves through your hand, but doesn't buckle and isn't super loose. So if it feels too tight like mine does, I'm going to go counterclockwise to go down. So I like to say clock up, count down.
So clock up.
Mm-hmm. So if it's too loose, go
count
up.
Count down.
Clock up or count down. So I'm going to go counterclockwise to go down a little bit, and then I'm going to feel the piece of paper again. It's still a
little. And what are you using in the middle, or are you using to the side?
So I'm doing the one right here in the middle.
Okay.
And so if you can't reach into there, you can always pull this build plate out, and then you should be able to reach the knob much easier.
Okay.
tie that with this?
No, the inside one.
So should I be able to pull it a little like this?
Yeah, that looks like it's pretty good tension. So it should kind of slide back and forth. And you can still feel a tension on it, but it shouldn't be loose.
Oh, it doesn't slide forward. So it won't go push back, but it'll pull out.
Yeah, if it's buckling when you're trying to push it forward, it's too close.
Okay.
And so this is something you kind of get used to as you level the build plate more and more, and your students will get good at it as they use it. It's just something that's really hard to teach over a video conference. As long as you feel like it's a comfortable tension, we can move on to the next knob.
So is this fine?
Yeah, do you still feel tension on it, or does it feel too loose? You want to feel the paper drag a little bit.
Oh, I can feel it dragging.
Okay, yeah, then it should be good on that knob. The next thing we're going to do is we're going to move the extruder out, and we're going to do the same thing for the two outside knobs. And so again, mine is much too close. So I'm going to count down or counterclockwise. I like to do small quarter turns just so I don't go too far.
Okay.
All right, I like that tension that I have, so I'm going to stop on that one.
All right, I'm supposed to be getting counter on her.
Yep, count down, walk up.
Okay. Oh, no.
Too loose that time, huh?
Yeah. Yeah. I think this is, well.
It looks a little tight.
Yeah.
There you go. Okay. And then we need to do that just once more here on that back nut. So all we have to do is move the build plate forward, and then we should be able to adjust it again. And so mine is still too close, so I'm going to go counterclockwise. All right, so I like where mine's at now, and I'm good.
I think mine's a little tight up here. Okay. I think it's good.
All right, sounds awesome. So the next part that we're going to do is I want you to go ahead and auto home it one more time. So that goes to setup.
So hit the button. Auto home.
Yep.
Did you go out and make that?
So we just leveled the build plate, but what I want to do is I want to heat up that nozzle, and we're going to level it build plate again. The only reason for this is that whenever we, before we ship you the printers, we do a test print on them, and what could happen is that there's leftover plastic on the nozzle. And if that's the case, then we didn't level quite right. So if you could click and go to setup, and then choose the selection PLA this time.
Okay, setup, preheat, PLA.
Exactly. And so what's going to happen is the screen here is going to change a little bit, and it's going to show you here at the top, it's going to say 220 degrees. That's the value it wants to go to, and then the bottom number here is the value that it's currently at. So it looks like about at 60 degrees Celsius. And so it's heating up through it. Once it gets to 220, again, we're going to slide our piece of paper under the nozzle. And then we're going to go through the motions of leveling it one more time. And this is just to double check. And this isn't something that you have to do every time, but if you do move it to a new position, or you saw a kid messing with the knobs underneath, it's a good thing to check for. And so I think it would be good practice for each of your students to kind of double check if they're doing a print for the day that they should level the build plate. So mine's almost heated up to 220. It's at 210. Yeah, and yours is getting there as well. All right, so mine's at the right temperature. Now I'm going to start leveling mine the same way we did before. So I'm going to put the extruder directly above the inside knob and feel the tension. So oddly enough, mine feels a little bit loose. That's probably because I knocked a little bit of the plastic off the nozzle head, and now it's a greater distance than I thought it was. So I'm going to have to higher it just a little. Mm-hmm. Okay. Then I'm going to do the two outside ones.
Yeah, mine's loose, so.
Yeah, exactly. So that's why we kind of go through that process. We want to make sure that we do level it correct so that it prints right the first time. Awesome. Now all my knobs feel about even, so I'm going to go ahead and just unplug my printer. The reason I unplugged it here is because the nozzle was hot, and in order to reset our settings, it's easy to unplug the fail safe, is what the idea is for these printers, and it'll immediately start deheating the nozzle.
Okay, hold on. Let me see if I can get this. I'm still too loose. Isn't it clockwise to tighten it?
Yes, clock up, count down.
Yeah. Should it be tighter than this?
No, that looks good. Do you feel a small amount of tension on it?
Yes.
Yes, then it looks like it's comfortable like that.
It's just not right. It's probably too tight. Mm-hmm.
So did you get the build plate leveled for it?
I feel like it's almost completely loose and my paper's not even going through here. Like my thing's almost coming off. So.
Try pushing down on the build plate and then slide it under the nozzle.
Hello?
Yes?
Hello?
Can you still hear me, sir? Hey, did I lose
Hello? It? Hello? I can't hear him.
Yeah.
And this is messing up.
Hey, Sarah, can you hear me now?
I cannot hear you.
Uh-oh. All right, can you hear me now?
I cannot. Just... It's like I'm talking on my phone.
Yeah, let me try and change the setting here to see if I can make it a little bit better.
$30
He
had
a year.
I did a grant for it.
Do what?
I did a grant for him this year.
Hey, Sarah, can you hear me now?
Oh, that's hot.
There we go. Was it what?
No, because we got a new person, so I just gave her everything I did, and she kind of beefed it up. I mean, you just got to put, like, why you're going to use it. But it all wasn't, right. it wasn't too bad.
Can you
use
it all now?
Oh, yeah. Bye. Hello?
Yeah, Sarah, can you still hear me?
No, it's like it's gone off speaker.
Okay, let me double check a couple things.
Huh? Hello?
I'm trying to adjust settings so that you can hear me a little bit better.
Okay.
All right, can you hear me now?
I think so. I can't hear him though.
Hey, Sarah, are you still having a couple problems with it?
I still can't hear. It's like I'm talking on my phone.
So am I?
It was on like a speaker. Like right now I'm having to hold my phone up like I'm talking to you on it to get it to be able to hear you.
Oh, is the speaker not working on your phone? Like the
It was, and then I don't know why it's not working anymore. Hold on. Hello?
Yes.
Okay, it's back on again. I just had to turn it off, turn it back on.
Okay, sounds good. Alrighty, so did you get the build plate level?
Do what?
Did you get the build plate leveled now?
Yes, I think it should be.
Okay, good. As long as you feel comfortable with it, I'm comfortable with it.
It's a little tighter, but when I had it at the spots, let me move it again.
Yeah, if you ever feel uncomfortable with it, how it feels leveled, of course you can always go and do it again. And just double check. It never hurts
again. Let me do a little.
Alrighty, just for a little recap, the first part we kind of went over the four steps to print, which was kind of model, slicing, transport to the printer, and then clicking the print function. Then we went over the Kiro settings and slicer settings, and then we touched base on troubleshooting and leveling the build plan. And so we have only a small section left to cover, and then we should be good to go.
Okay.
So once you have the build plate leveled, what we're going to do is we're going to again click on setup. We're going to click on auto home.
All right, so setup.
And then we're going to click PLA.
Wait, you said what after setup, auto home?
Yeah, you're going to auto home, and then you're going to preheat PLA just to make the nozzle hot. If yours already is, then that's okay. And so what we're going to go
over now
is...
I do have a question, though.
Yes, of course.
So is there supposed to look like, if I bend down, is there supposed to look like there's space in between the little nozzle and the plate, because it doesn't look like there's like very much space. It just looks like it's enough for the paper, but that's fine, right? That's how it's supposed to be.
Yes, that's exactly how it's supposed to be. So we want it to be just that certain distance away, so it lays down a small line of plastic.
Okay,
so what we're going to do now is once it preheats and it's at 220 degrees Celsius, I want you to take your tools that you have in your toolkit, and we're going to go over loading filament and unloading filament.
Okay.
And so we're going to grab a strip of our filament we have, and I like to clip it at an angle like this. And so it's a pretty steep angle, and it helps us to feed it through.
Okay.
And so it should come to a little point. Next, what I'm going to do is here at the back where we remember having the E motor, there's a small little hole right next to this spiral axis. We're going to pinch the yellow knob and we're going to push it through that hole. And then we're going to keep...
So push through at what hole?
Right here. So in the back of the printer, where we have E wire.
Oh, I forgot which one was E. Okay. So at the E wire.
Mm-hmm. So if you can kind of see that on my screen there. Right here. So it's going to be a little tiny hole. Right there.
I'm supposed to figure out where you put it through.
It's right next to the big spiral screw that's going vertically.
So am I pushing it through right here?
Nope, just a little bit over. So you see how this knob kind of has this curve here?
There.
So you're close to the right spot. You're just looking at the spring. So maybe turn it a little bit to the side. Yep, that direction. And there should be a small hole right next to the spiral axis. So
right next to this?
So does this view help you a little bit more?
Oh, I see it right here.
Yeah, exactly. And all you have to do is you have to pinch this knob together, and then you can feed it through.
Okay.
Okay, and we're going to feed it all the way to the nozzle. So it'll go pretty far, and then you'll feel it hit a stop, and you should be good.
Okay.
So you should be able to see it kind of go through this big tube here, and then once it gets to the nozzle point, you'll feel resistance, but if you keep pushing, it'll actually give a little bit, and what it's doing is now extruding plastic out of our nozzle point. So if I put it up for you to look at, you can see that there's now plastic sitting here.
It's sitting on our...
on your build plate.
Okay. I don't see it yet, so that means I need to push more through?
Correct. And if you want to raise your nozzle up, you can always grab this spiral on the back and turn it to move this up and down.
Wait, grab what?
This spiral.
Uh-huh.
And then turn it. You're going to turn it clockwise, and it should pull it up.
Okay.
And then it should be easier to see if the filament is pushing through.
So, I'm pinched. I see it now.
You see it? Awesome.
Yeah.
So it kind of came out like spaghetti for me.
Yeah.
And we were just wanting to make sure that it was getting all the way through. And so that's just loading filament. And so if you have another color in there before, you're going to want to push this extra filament through so we get our color.
Okay.
Okay? So what I want you to do next is I just want you to go ahead and unplug it, because I'm going to go over a troubleshooting step called soft pull. So let's just unplug our printers.
Okay.
And remember, unplugging our printers is pretty much the fail-safe that we have. If you feel like the motor's kind of making nasty noises, or something's not going right, or it's printing a big pile of spaghetti, you can unplug it. And it's not going to hurt anything, but you will have to start a print job over again if you do unplug it in the middle.
Okay.
Okay, so what we're going to go over now is unloading filament. So one problem for troubleshooting that happens often is clogs. And clogs happen within the extruder, and that's either because there's just so much plastic in there and it dried and it got stiffened and clogged up, or the nozzle was left hot and it was not printing. What happens in that case is it turns into a black carbon mold, and it's a really, really bad clog. And so something called soft pull helps us remove that. So I want you to go ahead and plug your printer back in. And I want you to wait for your nozzle to get probably around 50 degrees Celsius.
Okay.
And then we'll change, and then we'll go through the process. And the reason that we want it to be cold before we heat it up to a certain degree is so that it solidifies.
Mm-hmm.
And what I mean by that is that...
what part's going to say 50 degrees?
I'm sorry?
You said you want it to be 50?
Yeah, maybe a little bit lower than 50, and we can tell that right here on the status screen. Yeah, so it's still cooling off from us having it heated
up. Okay.
So let's let it cool off, and the reason why is because the plastic inside will solidify. And then when we heat it up from a solidified state, it becomes a transitional phase that kind of clumps everything that's in that nozzle, and whenever we pull it out, it helps to pull that nasty gunk out with it.
Okay.
So that's what we're doing when a soft pull. We're getting it in that transition phase, going from a hard plastic into a molten material.
Uh-huh.
And so you do have to do this from a lower temperature than to 100 degrees Celsius. So if you do it from a higher temperature, it's not going to quite work right.
So it's best at 50.
It's best from a cold state. We're just saying okay. 50 here because it was so hot previously. And for the time's sake, we're going to kind of pull it after that.
Okay.
So once it starts to dip to below, just let me know and we'll go over the last final steps of it.
You said once it what?
Once it gets below 50 degrees, let me know.
Okay. Now, what is the largest size that this 3D printer can make?
So the largest size that this 3D printer can make is I have a what we call a binding box. And this is the entire dimensions that it can make. And so this is a 6x5x4 box. And 6x5x4 inches. So that's the largest dimensions it can possibly make.
Yeah. Okay. And you just made a store, huh?
You have any other questions while we're waiting on these?
So you just made that a storage. So how do you keep it from doing the top or the inside? Is that something that I can do when I'm, like you were showing me to mess around with the keychain? I would change those dimensions in there?
So that is something that you would do inside the model creation. So that's during the design process. So very first, we're going to create the design, and then we change it to an STL and put it in the slicer. So during the design process, or something like Tinkercad or Onshape, what we could do is we can create a box, and we can hollow it out with negative space. And that's how you would create something similar.
Mm-hmm. And it was, can you spell the Tinker for me again?
Yeah, it's T-I-N-K-E-R-C-A-D.
And it's tinkercad.com?
Correct.
Okay. All right. Mine's at 40.
All righty. Mine is too. So I want you to click the button once. We're going to go to setup again. And this time we're going to go to preheat soft pull at the bottom. And I want you to click that button.
So
that's going to start changing to 100 degrees. Yep. Preheat soft pull. Correct. It's going to heat it up to 100 degrees Celsius, or that transition temperature for this type of plastic, and then we'll pull it out.
Okay.
Alrighty, so mine's at 100, so I'm going to go ahead and pinch this back knob where we threaded it last time. And I'm just going to pull the filament out. So it might be a little bit tough, but that's kind of what we're looking for. And mine looks real stringy, but that's what a soft pull can look like.
Okay, so it's at 100.
Yep.
Pinch and pull it out.
Yep, pull the line, exactly.
Okay, so mine kind of look like this. Where is it? This one I got done.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's good. So that was a soft pull, and it did its job. So it kind of pulled out all the material that we had in it, and now we should be good to put any other material in it. So if you still feel like it has a clog, you can do a soft pull multiple times.
Okay.
So in order for this instructional video to end, we kind of need to print something. So let's go ahead and clip our plastic from the point that it kind of got weird and stringy.
And we're still doing it at diagonal?
Yes, at a diagonal helps a lot when you're pushing it through. Kind of like.
Okay.
Okay, and I'm going to push that back through, and we can leave it at the temperature it is. And now we're ready to print. So the moment you've been waiting for. Now all we have to do
so clip push back.
Yep. Go ahead.
Okay. And then I'm gonna turn this again.
Yep, you're gonna push the button and then you tell me.
Okay, I'm pretty sure the
all the way through.
Yep.
Now it does kind of look like I got some plastic stuck on the tip of it from the one that we just did.
Yeah, so some there's some residue of plastic on the nozzle.
Yeah.
It wouldn't be a problem, but if you do want it to be clean, you can always kind of grab some pliers and you can clean that off, or when it's cooled off, you can scrape it. Well, I would recommend while it's hot, if you do want it to be extremely clean in the nozzle, which will get covered in plastic, I would grab some of these pliers from your toolkit and you can kind of scrape off the nozzle.
Okay.
But that shouldn't hurt our print here.
Okay.
So the next part, we got to click it once, and then we're going to click print from SD.
Okay, so I'm hitting print from SD.
Yep. And then all you have to do is select your keychain file. And that's it. So does it say heating down here at the bottom?
Yes.
Perfect. It's starting to print. So what it's going to do is it's going to heat up to that temperature that it has at the top. And then it's going to go to home or 000. And then it'll start printing.
Okay. So do I need to move the plate or will... It moved. I just moved it, but nope. When
don't worry about it. It'll do it all itself.
Okay.
Yep. Before it starts, it'll do it itself. Yes. And that's it.
All right.
So usually we won't have to go through so many steps, and it'll be a lot quicker. But mm-hmm. So this video, we kind of had to get across all of the things that we may need to check if there's problems with your print.
So yeah.
First went over the steps to print, which was designing, and then we're going to go to STL or the slicer program, and then we're going to transfer to printer, and then we're going to click print.
Okay, so if I got an image off the internet,
right?
Like for the button, if I found that image, then I would have to convert it.
So if you want to find a file from online, I recommend you find a .stl file, and you can slice that and print it.
So .stl
correct.
File. And when you say slice it, you mean what we did when I put this flash drive in my computer?
Exactly, yes. The program called Kira. That's a slicer.
Okay.
All right, mine started to move, so it should be good to go. It's kind of...
Yeah, mine's moving.
All righty. And we'll let it go through a little bit so that we know that we kind of did everything right. And hopefully the plastic will stick and it'll look good.
Okay. Now, is there... There's probably no way to do, I guess, where if you wanted to do something with a logo,
there
it could
is.
Be like where... Huh?
There is. Yes. So
two colors.
So you're looking for a two color logo?
Yeah, let's say I wanted to do a keychain for my student organization. Like I wanted my kids to design a keychain.
Right.
If they did, would they be able to do like the keychain red and then put the letters in white?
Yes, as long as the letters are above the red keychain every area. So what you would have,
okay.
You would have your flat keychain, and then you would have raised letters here. And so you mm-hmm. print this layer in whatever color you desire. And then if you click mm-hmm. on this button once and you scroll down to change filament while it's printing, it'll stop the print and it'll move to the side. And then you can change the type of filament that you have. And then it'll allow you to continue printing.
Okay, but that's like a kind of on you to make sure you change it and...
Right, so you'd have to be watching the print and go, oh, I need to kind of change it at this point in time.
Okay. Because I'm watching this one. Well, I guess when I would design it with the letters raised.
Yes.
Because the letters on this one right now, they're indented, aren't they? That's why
right,
it looks...
They are.
Because it did the outline and then it did the middle.
Right. So they are slightly indented. And so if that was the case, you wouldn't be able to change the colors of the letters themselves.
Yeah. And it's going to leave the hole for the hook to go in, right?
Correct. It's printing it right here on mine. Right here.
Okay, yeah, that's what I was looking at.
Yeah.
So but I can probably find a keychain template on the Tinker or OnShop?
OnShape, yeah. Actually, if you go to our website, there is a tutorial to make a keychain in Tinkercad.
Okay.
And that should be a great instructional video to kind of start what you're thinking for. Yes. So is it printing out for you?
If I can get a fit. Yes, it is.
Yeah, it's looking good. Awesome. So how do you feel about this process? I know it took a little bit longer than we expected, but.
It did, but then again, you're working. Our technology here is kind of slow, so that kind of took a little bit. But I really like this, and I can see from, you know, other people that I know that have 3D printers, it takes so much time and it's so difficult on theirs. And this one just seems so easy. And it doesn't seem like it will be hard for my kids to grasp this because there's not too many steps that they'll get confused on it. It seems like, you know, it's simple.
Right. A big portion that we went over today was all troubleshooting steps. So that was all the last half of what we did. And you don't necessarily have to go over that every time, or even when you start printing with your kids. You'll just want to do that whenever mm-hmm. you do come across problems. And it does help for them to have that knowledge.
Yeah. And if I wanted to, I would do this in design too. If I wanted, well, I guess, yeah, I would do it in design. If I wanted to make this thicker.
Yeah, you could either scale it, which you could scale the height by itself and make it higher that way, or you could do it during your design process.
Oh, so on the 3D printer, I can, are you saying I can scale it or?
So remember in our slicer, there is the option to scale. And
yes.
You can either have uniform scaling to where it keeps its proportions, or you can scale one axis by itself.
Uh-huh.
And so if you decided to change the Z axis in the slicing settings, then it would raise the object up.
Okay.
And it would make it a bit thicker.
And I like it tells me how much time there's left on it.
So the time that it actually has on there tells you mm-hmm. how long it's passed. So it says 5 minutes.
Oh.
5 minutes have passed since we started it. And if you wanted to see how much time that it may take, Cura actually gives you that estimate in the bottom right-hand side of the window.
Yeah, I was going to say, it says, I thought it was like, you got 5 minutes left, and I was thinking, well, I swear it said 19, so hey, we're doing pretty good.
Yeah.
That's so how much time it's got.
Exactly.
Okay. Now here's my other thing.
Yeah.
So I'll have multiple kids using these. We got the 6, so it's going to be, you know, 6 at a time that are able to use these.
Okay.
I'm going to be in there when they're using it so I can make sure they're doing what they're supposed to do, even after I train them, because I'm just so OCD like that.
Certainly.
And the flash drives, one came with each one of them. Is it, if I want to keep the designs and stuff that kids do on there, is there somewhere that I can, use any kind of flash drives that have a SD card, or is it specific one?
So the one that we use, you can put files on any flash drive that you would desire, but not all of them are going to be able to plug into the printer. So what we use today was a micro SD card. And if you want to use anything else and still be able to put it into the printer, you will have to use a different type of micro SD card.
Okay, so it's not like a flash drive area to put it in.
No.
Okay, and also it kind of looks like next to the USD, it almost kind of looks like an old charger port.
Yeah, so what that port actually is for that big blue wire that you had earlier. So that's what you're kind of packed. And so this is a USB wire. So these printers are capable of connecting directly to a computer. And so that is something you can do. The only reason we don't particularly recommend it is if that printer, if that computer falls asleep, or if it logs off, or if it accidentally gets unplugged, the print will stop.
Okay.
And so all you would need to do to set that up is plug this wire into the port here, and then plug the USB to your computer. And then it should auto detect it. And then all you have to do is click, let me show you real quick.
Okay.
And Cura, the top right hand corner here. And it should detect your printer and connect for it.
Okay.
And Cheryl, I can show you that if you'd like.
That's probably okay, because after you saying that about the computers falling asleep, I probably won't want to hook them up to a computer.
You can always make a dedicated computer that is always on and prints consistently if you would like, but it's just kind of something that we like to say that we like to have these autonomous so that we don't have to worry about them, you know, disconnecting or falling asleep or whatever. So, you know, I can move this guy around all I want because all I have is a power cable and the filament.
I was surprised, I guess I didn't pick, you know, I was looking at these when I went to the HISTI conference.
Yeah.
And I was talking to the people at the HISTI conference. I never picked it up, and I was so surprised when I picked it up to move it in my room how light it was. Because what I do is I have a storage room in my department, and so I have them set up in the storage room.
Right.
And I'm just going to have that be the station with my design stuff in it. And so I just moved it in here so I'd have my board, and I'm like, this is so easy to carry and move it around.
Yeah, so they are very mobile, and so they don't always have to be in that same spot. And maybe if, you know, another teacher wants to use one, they could always be transported through their room.
Yeah.
Awesome. Sounds like you're good to go, Sarah. How do you feel?
I feel really good. Thank you so much.
Yeah, of course. And then, go ahead.
When this is done, I just pull the plug. There's no like off switch I need to do or anything, or you know, cool down or anything like that.
Is unplug it, correct? And whenever it finishes a print, it'll actually move to the side, and then it'll immediately cool down the nozzle.
Okay.
And so if you leave a print overnight, that's what it's going to do if it does finish. So you shouldn't have any worries, and you can leave it printing for a very long time.
So I could leave work and leave it here at the school, and it'd be fine me coming back in the morning.
Yeah, and you know, if you have like a 14-hour print or something and you can't stay there all day to watch it, you can leave it and you can leave it printing. Once it finishes printing, it'll stay on and it'll just move to the side and cool off.
Okay. And then I don't have to click anything, I can just pull the SD out.
Yep.
Okay, so this seems really good.
Yeah, so if you feel like uncomfortable with something or it's making funny noises or anything, just unplug it. And then you can always pull the SD out and check your Cura settings and check the project file. And it's really simple and really intuitive.
Okay, so what happens if I'm in the middle of making something, or I have a student in the middle of making something, and we notice something's wrong in the design or the size looks? Because they're also going to use this to make like mini furniture for their housing structures that we're going to build, and they got to build rooms.
Okay, that sounds super awesome.
Furniture.
So if something's wrong in the design while it's printing, like it's kind of printing like this is now, and a student looks at it and they go, oh no, that's wrong, we can't do that. then yes, you can unplug the printer and it'll immediately stop the print. And then you can take the SD card out and clear the build plate, change your file how you want it, and I'll plug it back in.
Okay, remind me what the build plate is. That's the blue plate, right? That's moving right now?
Yeah.
Okay.
Awesome. You have any other questions, Sarah?
I think I'm pretty good. Thank you so much.
Yeah, of course. So after this, I'm going to go ahead and stop.